Welcome to Project Comedy, a podcast by and for military veterans doing stand-up comedy, turning military banter into quality stand-up comedy acts. We might be veterans, but our comedy aims to get everybody laughing. So on Sunday the 3rd of April in Greater Manchester, history was made. Three of the ambassadors actually met in person, not on Zoom as we have done for the last 18 months or so. Besser, we met the man, the legend, Jay Sodagar, who taught us and is still our mentor. But best of all still, we all gigged together and got great laughs. I'm joined by the ex-Army Irishman that charges for subtitles, Gabriel Murphy, an ex-RAF Keir Starmer sound-alike, Jamie Johnson, active RAF Regiment reservist, but we're still nice to him, Dan Wright, and I'm the former naval officer with an assistant dog that's 10 times more attractive than me. Trust me, that's what the audience kept on telling me. And I'm Jay Saunders. Gents, welcome.
Hello.
Hello.
How do?
So three of us have actually bloody met now.
I know, imagine.
Awesome.
I know you weren't there, Dan, but it felt so freaky. When we actually, you know, I came out into the beer garden and saw you, Gabe. It felt like we had known each other for bloody years. It was exactly the person I was expecting. Well, I wasn't expecting your missus, but it was exactly the person I was expecting.
Was the beard as impressive in person as it is on the screen?
Dear God, yes. What was it actually like, though, meeting up for the first time, though, guys?
It was magical.
It was incredible, really.
You liar.
It was great to speak to you without any lag. buffering. In fact, didn't we say we needed cardboard cutouts that we could hold and just pause? Yeah.
Did Jay freeze in real life just at random point? Like, leave you on massive cliffhangers.
The only reason we knew we were in real life is because Hawk's tail was wagging.
No, man, it was good. It was a long time coming, I think.
Too long, eh?
And, you know, it's going to be great for the next time. If we get around to doing it again, like.
Right, so I just lost Wi-Fi then for a second, guys. Sorry.
Give over. You never did.
One lost Wi-Fi for one moment.
Next you'll tell me this French surrendered or something.
On an officer's pension, surely you can afford Wi-Fi.
Oh, my God.
Can you imagine if the RAF regiment did Wi-Fi, though? You'd have to have the barrier up.
I think you saying that your Wi-Fi is like Audi Wi-Fi just gives Audi a bad name.
we were saying that you on your officer's pension should be able to afford a decent Wi-Fi.
Yeah, well, I probably could, but the problem is every time it's low tide, it won't connect.
Imagine if that's the thing that you have to worry about on your Wi-Fi.
Oh. Mate, that happens daily to me. But when we were up there, again, another person we met for the very first time was Jay Sodagar.
Yes,
the man, the myth, the legend.
What was it like meeting Gay? I know what it was like for me, but what was it like actually meeting the man himself?
I was impressed with how tall he was. I thought he was a lot shorter and, you know, he would have been a lot shorter. I was impressed with how tall he was.
I did see the picture. Is he like 5'6"?
The bit that got me, that we've never seen before, obviously, is how animated he is on the stage. Yeah. I mean, we know what his lines and what his delivery is like, but how animated he is when he's getting an audience to work with him, it's so much more. It's like we actually saw the real Jay Sodagar, not just the tutor.
Exactly. Yeah, definitely. 100%.
And then on top of that as well, we also had Neil Houlihan and his dear lady wife. Neil's the CEO of Project Recce that made Project Comedy available. It was so great to have him in the audience to see what we're actually doing.
Just for the extra laugh. What I was going to say, Jay, that having all these familiar faces in the room definitely settled my nerves, especially as it was my first real comedy gig.
Well, no, that doesn't count, surely. I mean, that was, even just as it, for the experience, that looked pretty tough with it being mixed in with music and everything as well. So,
Oh, yeah.
I must admit, you did well there. But you've got a couple under your belt now. It's like, you know, no stopping.
It's so different. It's so different in a room of people. You can hide behind your laptop, can't you? Real people is so different.
Yeah, yeah, I imagine. One day.
I mean, I got so lucky on my first gig that a dear friend of mine, Steve came down from Birmingham to watch me do my gig. So that was amazing. We did the Warrior Games together. He's just about to depart for the Invictus Games. And to have my mate in the back of the room just sticking his thumbs up going, you can do this, you can do this. That made it so much easier to get through my first ever gig.
Yeah.
Go on. How nervous were you guys?
Okay. I've got to admit, I was super nervous.
You didn't look it.
I wasn't nervous at all. I was probably in bed when you was all gigging.
It's the rock and roll lifestyle, mate. That's what we're having. I was thinking that myself, like, you know, after I'd got off the stage, I was that knackered. I was like, I'm normally in bed by 9:30.
What we need to have is gigs at midday.
I've been knackered all day.
Now we're talking.
Yeah.
I was knackered all day. 12
to half two, that'll do me. Go home, have something to eat. Have your dinner.
Now I get, the older I get, the earlier I wake up as well. I find now that I actually wake up the same time as what I used to go to bed. Yeah. So I'm starting to meet in the middle.
Oh just my God, this, boys.
To meet this shadow.
You're making it sound like the old people's room in here. And I'm the old shit.
Well, Jay, considering how old you are, you must get up really early now.
Sod that. The PTSD keeps me up at night.
Do you know what? The thing I liked just before the gig started, though, was the running order, how the running order fell in. Jay Sodegar says to us, right, you what spots do you want? We've got number one, number four, and number five. And quick as a flash, Gay said, I'll have number one. That takes balls of steel to me to open.
I just wanted to get it over and fucking done.
And I'll tag in here. We will make the videos of our performances available on YouTube when this podcast goes live.
Shameless.
So you can actually see what we were like, Dan, if you would actually had the courage to come and play with us.
Yeah, that sounds
incredibly pedophilic.
So when Gabe said that he'd open, and I said, right, four and five left. Right, I can't go after Jay. I cannot follow the legend that is Jay Saunders. So I'll take four shots. And Mr. Sodegar said, well, that works fine because that would mean I closed the first half and Jay had opened the second half. And I think that worked like a dream.
Now Jay's got 15 gigs under his belt. He's like a seasoned pro.
Seasoned veteran. Yeah.
Comedy veteran. Vet.
I mean, my scary bit was getting there because I had 7 hours on a bloody megabus that got lost on the way.
Yeah. Did you get lost getting out of bit
for the environment?
No, because I'm just a cheapskate. It was about £110 cheaper than going by train.
It must have been a nice thing to just see regular smackheads instead of inbred smackheads, though.
Smackheads with an IQ of more than 10.
How did it feel? How did it actually feel to be on a physical stage rather than a Zoom stage?
It was it was better. As nervous as it, you know, as nerve wracking as it was much better. A feeling it to be, I don't know, I'm fucking babbling here, aren't I?
I think just the dynamics of the room made it better. Just, rather than staring into a screen and suffering with all the technological drops that Zoom gigs have, just being in a room with people, you're going to get instant feedback. It was 100 times better for me. Once the first laugh dropped, I got the first punchline in, and I got a laugh. And after that, I was on a roll, and I know Gabe felt the same.
How was it? Yeah. I suppose it made a massive difference with the connection as well, I imagine.
Oh, yeah, because you could see people were actually engaging with you as opposed to just sitting on the sofa and drinking wine and absolutely watching TV while you were there.
Yeah.
And you get to look in their eyes. You get to look in the eyes of somebody that's enjoying what you're saying.
Yeah. I mean, I think on my graduation gig on Zoom, I literally had somebody turn around to the wife and say, "Turn that shit off the telly," which is slightly off-putting.
When you actually got off the stage, how did you feel? I mean, was there a difference from doing a Zoom gig?
Thirsty. I was incredibly fucking thirsty.
You had 2 points to Guinness lined up.
Yeah, no, they weren't there long.
That's Irish water.
It was comforting and a relief, you know, at the same time. Because like the only other time that I can compare it to really is when I've been fighting and stuff like that, you know, in the mixed martial arts cages and stuff. And it was a completely different feeling to that, because obviously doing a competition like that, you've won and the other fella hasn't, so you're like, no, 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 no. And then but when you've come off after doing your set and you feel like it's gone well, you know, you've got that instant high.
Gabe, is it the same as I've never done any MMA, but I've done some jiu-jitsu competitions.
Yeah.
And you know, when you've won and the referee takes your arm and puts your arm up, is that like the finishing? You've finished your 5 minutes there and it's like that.
It's very much like you say, that instant high, like, you know,
that little bit of achievement, like, and he lifts your hand up and the whole crowd are there, your friends are there, and they're like,
it's mint. And and weirdly, because like after doing a competition like that, you get that instant drop off, so it's like, yeah, I won, and then everything's back to normal. But like when we've done the gig, like I constantly felt like, you know, people were still having fun, and it was like I had a hand in that, even though I wasn't doing the jokes at the time. Still had a hand in that because everyone was having a good time. And it was like every single time Jay Sodagar said, "Oh, you're having a good time," and everyone was like, "Yeah," it was like, "Yeah," because a little bit of that was a bit, I'm fucking happy about it.
Yeah,
great.
But do you think you got in some way, and then do you think you got to enjoy it more from going first? Because once you've been, and then you could sit down and relax and watch everyone else and become part of the show then.
I would much rather prefer to go on first and then either bomb and leave it for everyone else.
That's arguably the hardest spot, number one, and you just nailed it.
I wouldn't say I nailed it, but you know, I did. I think I did well.
Yeah, as we said before, the connection in the room and just the people were engaged and they wanted to laugh, and seeing stuff that I'd written down converted into laughs and claps, it was just fantastic. Yeah.
So did the audience give everyone a bit of a round of applause after each act? Or
yeah.
That must have
been applauding during the sets.
Yeah,
there was when a big joke landed, like people were clapping it, you know, and really cheering for the really funny bits.
Yeah,
it was really, really good.
Imagine that.
I don't know about you guys, but the habit I've got into now is as I come off, I've still got the high, but I'm going, right, did that bit work? Did that bit work? And I'm already almost doing a critique in my head.
Yeah, of what bits went well, maybe what bits didn't quite go so well, what jokes really landed, and evaluating, giving yourself. Yeah. Did they say give yourself a rating out of 10, I believe, wasn't it, for each of the jokes? You know, did that the based on the reaction?
I came off thinking, did I get all my punchlines out right? And then thinking, no, I missed a slight bit there where I've got a bigger laugh from that. But it's the first gig I've done properly. So
exactly.
I'd rather come off thinking that was good, but I know I can do better. That's a good result for me, definitely.
Of course you'd do better. Everyone would do better, but I think the first one, just to do it, is a massive achievement, if you ask me.
Yeah.
And it's also that thing we've got on the intermediate course of find the bits that you did really well. And for me, when I went off, it was the fact I wasn't treading on laughs. I was actually giving them the space to laugh and waiting before I did my setup. And I walked away feeling really proud of that moment, that I was letting them have their full value of the laugh, and then I could go in with the setup that took me to another punchline.
Yeah.
Yeah, I think I was like instantly analysing myself, so then I think I kind of do that all the time anyway.
Dynamic. Yeah, yeah. Dynamic evaluations.
My dynamic shit assessment.
the thing for me, I found it 10 times easier to do it in a room than I did on Zoom. It's the instant feedback. You get the last and you're thinking, I know how long to leave it before I go to my next setup or drop the next punchline in.
That's that connection, I suppose, then, is it?
Talking about the connection, yeah.
But I think as well, like, now that we've like got up and done it, I think like my advice for other people is, like Jay Sadagar says, is to just get out there and gig. You know, even if you do, you know, even if you do dive and you bomb out, like, you know, it might happen. It could happen. You know, what's the worst that's going to happen is, you know, people think that you're not that fucking great, but then you go somewhere else and people are going to be thinking that you're brilliant.
Yeah, or someone shouts, boring. You're sick.
You've got to tell the story now, Dan. You've got...
No, I don't. We can leave it there. Save that for the next podcast.
Where I might fair, that's only not. The feedback I get from my missus, so...
I usually get that when I'm inside her.
Well, her saying you're sick.
You're sick, yeah. Boring. You're not even trying.
Stop flicking through your WhatsApp groups.
22 WhatsApp groups. It's just ridiculous. Mate. This is what my life has turned into.
It's fucking stupid, isn't it? I really hate it because I hate social media anyway. I think it's like since I've turned like 35, like going past 35, it's like social media is fuck it, can't be after it. Anyway. Like every single time I have to do something else, like I join another, like I go to the jiu-jitsu gym or I go to the pub, like dropping the little ginger prick off at school. If people want to add me into a fucking WhatsApp group there, nah, it's probably not a good idea.
Life is nowadays. I've got more. Oh, in fact, I've got more WhatsApp groups than friends. In fact, I've got more WhatsApp groups than a lot of things.
My missus said she was like that. Oh, you should get involved with that WhatsApp group with the parents. And I was like, nah. Can you imagine me just tying on? It's like, all right, and which little cunt kid's yours? Like, it's fucking dumb head in. I'd just be slagging off their kid to them. I just saw him now. I'd love to kick him in the fucking head. Like, what, you mean my kid? Like, yeah.
I remember it got me thinking about when on the last podcast when you was talking about your favourite jokes and favourite gigs. Where I think it made me think about what my favourite gig was, and I would have to say it was the one that we all put together ourselves.
The one that you emceed.
And then I done the MC, yeah. I think that was my favourite, to be honest.
Yeah, that was a new one, no.
Your face after game set.
You'll be glad to know I brought that back. Like it says now.
Did you do that on Sunday?
Yeah. It was really funny because me and Jay just looked at each other and kind of put a hoodies up. Are you gonna do it? Yeah, too right. He's gonna do it.
I was more nervous about doing the LGBT stuff because obviously we had a couple of lesbians in, and it was nerve wracking because I didn't know how well they would take it because obviously it's a 50-50 thing, isn't it? It's like, oh, they can either see the funny side of it or they can't.
Yeah, they're lesbians, they probably don't take it.
But it was just one of them, like, and it's just, to throw out such a 50-50 thing like that. And I'm just glad that it did land. I was going to, I got really confident. I had to, like, rein myself in because I was thinking about giving them a throwaway lesbian joke. How do you always win an argument with a lesbian? You do rock, paper, scissors and always pick rock because they can't resist scissors.
Oh.
They always go for the scissors.
So there's something that I want to know. Did any of you get approached in a Will Smith, Chris Rock type of fashion? I've been thinking about this for a long time now and I realise this is why Jazzy Jeff left, isn't it? It's finally dawned on me.
Well, Jamie's the only one that actually threw in a reference to the Will Smith Rock incident.
Yeah,
because I used it as a nice link out of one gagging into another. It sat quite nice.
Yeah, that was good. That was a good line, that as well.
And it worked so well. I mean, especially the groans you got about Jada. That was, you know, you've got a good gag, a naughty one, when the audience groan and laugh at the same time.
Yeah, she's trying to cut in on my do.
I'll never get as dark as you, Gabe.
I watched a bit of Jimmy Carr the other day, and he said, as an audience, you're supposed to laugh or groan, but you can't laugh and groan at the same time.
I think his exact line was laugh, okay, groan, okay, but you're not allowed to laugh, then suddenly think about it and go, oh, actually, no, now I disapprove of the joke.
Yeah, something along those lines. That was it. Like, you can't laugh and then go, ooh.
Here's a question I want to ask you guys, because, okay, so I've done a few more in-person gigs. Did you find that you prepared for this in-real-life gig in a different way than you did for a Zoom gig?
I prepared more, believe it or not. It might not fucking look it, but I did.
Well, yeah, well, we had a few run-throughs, didn't we, Jay? And I was using a deodorant can as a mic.
How ironic was that? Because there was no mic in that room.
There was no mic, yeah.
Maybe you should have run out and said, has anybody got any deodorant? I need to borrow this. And I know I'm going to set with a can of Lynx Africa in my hand because it's the only way I know I can do it.
Oh, Jay, you never... I think only Gabe saw it, but I had to do, you know, Jay's, Jay Sodegar's little one-minute routines that you've got to write.
Yes.
I did a minute on... Oh, I think it was antiperspirant, and I'll talk about Lynx Africa for about a minute. Perhaps I'll dig it out. And
we all had to do a minute on the other. Antiperspirant, sorry.
That was it, yeah.
You say that because the headliner, so the guy that's done the advanced course that closed off for us, suddenly he started talking about contact lens solution. It was a really good set, and it was really dark and naughty and what have you. And I turned around and looked at Jay Sodegar and went, you little shit. And he's just pissing himself laughing. He went, yeah, it was a one-minute challenge I gave him, and he's now using it as part of his permanent set. And it's amazing when somebody gives you something as random as that, that it takes you to a different level.
I'll show you mine, Gabe. Do you remember my one on hair conditioner?
Yeah.
Yeah. I'll do my one on hair conditioner another day. I'll have to dig out my 1 minutes because I've quite liked the little 1 minute ones. I found them really fun.
I did one on pigeons. I wanted to kill Jay when he gave me, you've got to do 1 minute on pigeons. I mean, oh my God, what's this going to be? And when I did it, he freaking loved it because it took me to such a dark place.
Yeah. It's surprising being so restricted how flexible and how much freedom you can actually have.
I started comparing pigeons to the EDL because they're all arrogant, just shit all over everybody.
I love them. I love it though because, like, you know, a lot of people that I said that I've done this course with, they always go in like, "Oh yeah, but you're funny." Like, I'm not as funny as you, and it's like if you can make something like pigeons or fucking antiperspirant or conditioner funny, then you know anything and anyone is funny.
I want to ask this one. What do you think was your biggest? It's a horrible American phrase. What was your biggest takeaway from last night?
How was your journey, guys?
The kebab. The kebab I had on the way out.
How have you about your journey?
I think for me, the fact that people do think I'm funny, because my biggest hang up is I don't always think I'm funny. So to get the laughs and to feel the high at the end of the gig, making that room laugh.
Oh, mate, the one that I think I said it to you last night, that bit about Captain OCD, your new superhero.
Yeah.
And I was a little bit nervous how the light switch would go down, where you're going to turn. And I couldn't have been more wrong, because you were marching to the front to go and turn the lights off, the audience were so behind you, and they're going, "Fuck it, yeah, I know fucking nothing." That's it. The audience loved that.
Yeah, it was brilliant.
And that's kind of, I thought I'd add in a little bit of visual work as well, and it just dropped a treat. Yeah, I really like that.
That was the biggest thing that surprised me with you guys last night. Was, of course, you know, we've gigged together, we've gigged on Zoom, but to actually see you on stage and see your physicality, because we've all got three very different. I didn't realize, I was watching the video back last night, and I went, I don't realize how angry and how I start crouching down when I'm angry and start pointing at people. Where Gabe's there with the beard and leaning all over the place, and then subtly chinning people off. And then you, Jamie, you're really quite mobile around the stage. And we've never seen that in the 18 months of doing comedy, because we've always been confined to the little portrait frame.
So you enjoyed checking out everyone's physicality then, did you, Jay?
I saw you looking at me.
I've told you, 23 years in the Royal Navy, it's not gay if you don't push back.
It's definitely a high tide moment.
Did you get to tap the gate?
Yeah, I won't tell you about my tide marks as well.
The old plimsoll line.
I mean, do you want to do another one again, though? Do you want to do another physical again?
Oh, absolutely. Definitely. I'm chomping at the bit, to be fair, to do another one. Definitely. It's not put me off. And a little bit of what Jay Sadogar said, he said, if you just do this gig and then don't do it anymore, what's the point? You've learned a skill. Go out there and use it. And I was like, Gabe was saying, you can have a good gig, you can have a bad gig. It's like anything you do in life.
Yeah.
But the more you do it, the better you get, you hone your skills.
And imagine paying to join the gym and then only going once.
Exactly.
Or fucking knowing how to swim and then live in the Midlands.
Or learn to swim and move on a yacht.
Yeah.
Who'd do that?
Yeah. Some fucking nutter with a black lab.
I want to hear this joke about Jada, Jamie, anyway. What was this Jada one that made everyone go, ooh?
Oh, it was Jada, so... So basically, I'll run through my little piece. So I said, Chris Rock and Will Smith, yeah, they've made up now. They kissed and made up. Will's taking Chris out for a slap-up meal, but but Jada's pulling her hair out about what to wear. And then to close the little segment off, I said, but next time they go out, Chris is having the duck.
I mean, the reaction.
Imagine how screwed Chris Rock would have been if all the other guys that had banged Jade had rushed to the stage as well.
But it was the reaction in the room, because everybody, they instantly, it was just a chortle came out of their mouth and went, I really shouldn't be laughing at this. Is it okay for me to be laughing at this? And they were checking each other out in the room going, am I really allowed to be laughing to this?
It's kind of like the audience was self-censoring themselves. Yeah.
It was a fantastic night, and we're getting so much out of it. What I'll do, tell you what, this is the perfect opportunity. We'll just pause for 1 second, and here's how you can join Project Comedy. Are you a veteran, or even still serving, and think you'd like to give stand-up comedy a go? Then why not join us in Project Comedy? Visit the Project Recce website, that's projectrecce.org, then click on How It Works. You'll find a Register Here button in the Project Comedy section. Fill that in and the HQ staff will soon get you connected with the Project Comedy community and its weird and wonderful ambassadors. You'll be invited to our green rooms, where if you want it, we can train you in the basics. If not, you can just come along and have a laugh with us and see what we're up to and what it gives us. Looking back at doing that stand-up gig altogether, when you look at it now, what would you like to do differently? Is there something you would like to do differently in your preparation, or is there something you'd like to enhance in your sets? What would you do differently next time?
Not read me fucking notes.
It is a scary... I mean, your first ever gig, Gabe, you ended up doing a 10-minuter. Yeah. And that's not the way you start. You start with fives. Okay, we've been given a shortcut by Jay Sodagar. I mean, I only ever did 2 5-minute gigs and then was instantly invited onto the 10 set. But my first time on stage, I only had to have 5-minute material in my head. And it is that confidence of, can I put the script down? And knowing, right, I've got to leave the notes behind. That takes a lot of courage.
It was annoying for me because I knew what I was to say.
Yeah.
And it just, I think, I don't know what happened. Honestly, I've never experienced that before. I don't know whether it was just because I didn't know it as much as what I thought I did, or the other stuff that I've done public speaking about. I knew inside out.
I think for you and I, Gabe, it's the PTSD. We convince ourselves that we don't know as much as we know. There's that fatalistic thing about PTSD. I'm going to fuck this up. And your brain is just telling you you're going to fuck it up.
Yeah, might be that.
When I changed my mind, not my mind, but my technique of how to learn my script, of going from, I'm not learning the words, I'm learning my attitudes for the words that enable me to free you. It was so much better. It doesn't mean I come out with them exactly, because I fluffed about. I missed 4 punchlines and I fluffed 3 of them. But it doesn't matter because they still got laughs and I still was on the stage for 10 minutes. So I can't expect absolute perfection, because if I was perfect, why would I want to go on next time?
Well, the other thing that I think it was for me is that because I've been away from it for so, from public speaking for a while.
Yeah.
It's like I've not been to the gym for a long time, but I know that if I do go back, I'll go back trying to lift everything that I normally used to lift. So I'd probably fucking kill myself, but PTSD and that, I'd probably want it anyway.
Like me with archery. I mean, I love my archery, and I shot something called a Portsmouth round. We've normally got PBs, personal bests. I entered a competition. I scored a PW, a personal worst. I still came 3rd in the Royal Navy with that score, but it was a clear 100 points lower than what I normally score.
Were you the third of three?
Oh, I got the bronze medal, mate.
Yeah, but were you the third of three?
Yeah, out of three entrants.
No, no. There were six of us.
In mid-table.
Six of us and three of them didn't turn up.
That's usually what happens. Every time I arrange a threesome, I usually get a couple of no-shows.
I'm going to go back and sharpen up my attitude a little bit. Having seen my video, I'm quite happy with how mobile I am on the stage. I quite like that, so I'll done with that.
I mean, for me, what I'm so glad I've put it in my head. It's not something Jay taught us, but I like having the bankers. I like there are I like to have in thirds of the set gags that I know that get really big laughs. And knowing that psychologically, that's brilliant for me. No, okay, I'm about 2 minutes in. I'm going to drop this one now. Bang. And it gets really elevated laugh. Then you pause and halfway through the set, another one. And then having that banker at the end, which I love. I mean, Gabe, your banker at the end. I mean, I'm so sorry I put you off and started hiding my face from you.
I'll have to remember, that's from something I could change for next time, is just fucking ignore people and just carry on with what I'm doing.
And they're nice pacers, aren't they? They're nice pacers. You drop in a big one at the start, you get some good laughs, that G's you up, you're ready to go, bang, 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 you get some nice gags in there.
It's almost like milestones, isn't it?
One of the middle G's you up. Yeah. And then you finish on a nice big one as well. That's really worked really well for me, that did.
Start on a big one and finish on a big one.
Was it worth all the effort, though? I mean, for me, 14 hours on a megabus, I'm going to turn around and say, it was fucking amazing. I loved it. But was it worth the effort of getting out there and going, right, I'm going to feel the fear, do it anyway, just get on a stage and play?
I would absolutely 100% do it again. It's if anything, it's convinced me more that I want to carry on with this comedy journey. Yeah.
How's your comedy journey, guys? Tell me about, you've been on such a journey. Tell me about it.
This podcast episode was sponsored by the US military.
We started training as boys. Then we became men. We become intermediate men.
Intermediate men.
Oh, God. I'm still a beginner, man.
Oh, have you not done your intermediate
course? Oh, he's not doing the intermediate.
Yeah, I start that next week.
Oh, dear. Oh, I didn't realise.
That was something I wanted to bring up, actually, guys. What was it like to gig with... In real life with non-veterans? I know in the last podcast we talked about how we're all different. We all bring our unique sense of humour into the mix. Now we all were, but how did it feel to see civvies? And it was good to see how their minds work as well.
I love it. I love gigging with, I can't even call them normals or civilians and what have you, because the people we were gigging with last night, we had a young lady with autism. She was fucking fantastic. She was brilliant.
Off the scale. Yeah, really funny. Good set.
You had a school teacher that was just a wrong'un.
Not that kind of wrong'un.
That's the right Pompey term, that is, isn't it? You're right, old wrong'un him.
And then it closed off with a guy with, extreme cerebral palsy.
Yeah,
I think it gives us a little bit more. We're willing to go over the top. Yeah,
the thing
that
about comedy as well is you've got diversity, haven't you? There's so much diversity now. It seems to be anyway. Perhaps not in the past, but certainly at the moment, it seems as though there's a lot of diversity.
One of the other guys that was having this bit of a script last night. He did this whole existential crisis bit, which I did, I did my take on it, where I did 10 minutes of just me talking to myself,
yep.
And you know, so it just goes to show that you can have that overlap of jokes and humor.
Material.
You
know? Yeah.
Well, going back to Jay's 1 minute routines, I mean, some of us had the exact same thing, but yet they was all so different, weren't they?
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. You can have the same subject, and it's just your angle of view of it, isn't it? So.
Exactly. Yeah. Yeah.
Okay, then, Dan, you've brought it up. So here's a challenge for the next podcast. We know that you've got all your service life and your studies and all that sort of bollocks to get on with, but assign the three of us a 1 minute topic. I'll give you a second to think about it, but assign us a 1 minute topic, and the next podcast, we've got to drop in our 1 minute routine. Sound like a challenge, boys?
I'm in.
I'm up for that.
Well, I know I don't have to do the 1 minute challenge, but I've just got to give you. I've got to give you
We'd like you to, because we would like to convince this audience you actually exist and you know how to be funny.
I think you should MC it and give a 3 minute.
Well, a minute in between each one of your minutes.
You could be the filler.
Well, before he gives us that challenge, we give him a little bit of mental space to actually think about it. Gabe, Jamie, what are your next steps then? What's the next thing you want to do? You've done a live gig in front of real people. What do you want to do next?
Go to sleep. I think I want to get in touch with that Dom, the lad who closed out for us last night. Because like the amount of work he's said, you know, he's done. You know, I'd love to say to him, like, you know, because one of the things with it is, like, I feel like I'm getting into swinging, you know, and I've turned up to the party, everyone's throwing the keys into the bowl. I don't know what to wear. I don't know who to talk to. I don't know what to say. You know, I need to figure out the etiquette of what's going on.
So, to make sure you got the right keys.
Yeah, you know what I mean? I don't want to be making up some weird little faux pas, you know, stepping on someone's dick or whatever.
What about you, Jimmy?
Well, I've got my intermediate course coming up. That's the next set of drills for me, definitely. I always wanted to do at least a gig in person before I did the intermediate. That's achieved now, so I've got that to go off as my springboard onto the intermediate. So I'm ready for that. So that's my next step.
On the journey back, I ended up emailing two of my bookers going, I need a gig. I need a gig.
You said hookers then for a minute.
My balls are massive.
It's high time. The OAPedo again on the bus. The OAPedo.
Failed to mention, yeah, Jay's hookers are like octogenarians.
Triple vaccinated.
Oh, thank you.
See what happens on a high tide.
Go on then, mate. So what is our chart? What is our 1 minute challenge for the next one?
I've had a little think about it, and I'm gonna give Jay Elon Musk.
Okay.
I'm gonna give Gabe energy bills rising. Mm-hmm. At the moment, and Jamie, eBay.
Jamie, you've seriously been thrown under the bus there. That's the hardest one of the lot.
Do you think?
The e-bus.
eBay.
Okay.
So that's our challenge. That will be in the next podcast. If we can make it happen, I'm hoping that we'll have a very special guest in the next episode. But I think I'll close off by saying thanks so much, guys, for being here this evening. And as we close out, we'll give you the link on how you can catch up with Project Comedy and get involved with us.
Fantastic.
Pleasure.
If you'd like to see what we're actually like on the stand-up stage, please have a look at our YouTube channel. Search for Project Comedy on YouTube and look for our black and white logo that's exactly the same as we use for the logo for this podcast. And as for me, Jay Saunders, I can be found on Facebook, Instagram, Twitter. If you look for Comic Jay Saunders, that's all one word, with the letter J in the middle, Comic Jay Saunders. Thanks again to everybody that's taken part in this episode. Until next time. Thanks for listening to the Project Comedy Podcast. Please support our veterans as they continue their comedy journeys. To find out more, including gigs our veterans are doing, please search for the Project Comedy group on Facebook, where you'll also find links to Project Recce, the veterans charity that makes Project Comedy possible.